Nitrogen is the largest nutrient input in northern Australian cropping systems, but as well as water leaching it deep into the soil profile, nitrogen can be lost to the atmosphere through denitrification. In normally aerated soils, bacteria use oxygen from soil air pockets to respire. But if soils become waterlogged, microbes strip oxygen from nitrates in the soil, releasing various forms of gaseous nitrogen to the atmosphere. And once it's dissolved into thin air, there's no getting it back. Denitrification occurs when three conditions coincide.
You've got to have microbial activity, which means a source of carbon, source of food for microbes, like crop stubbles. You've got to have elevated nitrate nitrogen concentrations. So up here, that will be, say, at the end of a fallow period where we've mineralised nitrogen, or straight after a fertiliser application. And then you've got to have water logging or a shortage of oxygen.
Microbe activity increases in warmer weather, so hot, wet summers can lead to significant losses. Estimates put average losses for the northern grains region in the 2012-13 summer at 10 to 20 kilos per hectare. The 2010-11 wet season saw losses of up to 80 kilos. Research at Kingaroy in Queensland aims to provide solutions. Nitrous oxide, or N2O, is relatively easy to measure.
We're using automated chambers to measure nitrous oxide emissions. They're working 24/7, so basically they're opening and closing every half hour throughout the day, and so we get a total emission of nitrous oxide during that 24-hour period.
Other forms of gaseous nitrogen require an alternative method.
We can't measure N2 gas emissions as well, because there's so much N2 in our atmosphere. So what we've done also is put N15 or fertilisers with an isotope of nitrogen, N15, in with the normal fertiliser product, and we look at recovery of that isotope at the end of the season in the crop or in the soil.
The ratio of N2 to nitrous oxide, or N2O, can be as high as 40 to 1. So 2 kilos lost as nitrous oxide could mean 80 kilos lost as nitrogen gas, a significant hit to the farm budget. Past trials have compared slow-release fertilisers designed to reduce denitrification by keeping soil nitrate concentrations low until nitrogen is needed by the crop.
Some of them involve an inhibitor, a chemical inhibitor of nitrification. So basically they stop the microbes from going all the way through that conversion pathway. In other cases, it's a controlled release type product where you have a polymer coating around, say, a urea granule, which just so you get a trickle feed of nitrogen coming out rather than an instantaneous dissolving and availability.
Though the products trialled reduced losses by up to 60%, they're expensive. So one aim of the trial is to find out whether reduced application rates can still provide enough nitrogen for the crop. Reducing emissions will also have environmental benefits.
Nitrous oxide is a very potent greenhouse gas, so something like 300 times the potency of CO2. So you don't have to lose a lot of nitrous oxide to have a fairly significant greenhouse gas implications.
The project is part of a national initiative called NANORP, which includes research into aspects affecting N2 to N2O ratios, the use of different inhibitors to control nitrification rates, and the use of feedlot manures and wastewater treatment plant biosolids as sources of nitrogen. Next year, Mike will be trialling different legumes as a nitrogen source.
We know that, for example, a legume like soybean, which has got obviously a very digestible residue as far as microbes are concerned, tends to release nitrogen a lot faster than, say, residues like peanut. So we're looking at a soybean pre-crop and a peanut pre-crop, and then looking at the vulnerability of that legume nitrogen in the following summer.
Until slow-release products become commercially viable, the advice to growers is to keep a close eye on soil nitrogen levels, particularly after a large rain event.
I think it's important for growers to recognise when those denitrification events occur, soil test to see how much nitrogen they've lost, and then adjust the fertiliser rates accordingly. If we're asking people to soil test, we've got to give them the tools that they can then interpret that information with. And so that's the more profit for crop nutrition component of the program, is looking at that, those decision rules around how much nitrogen you need after you've got a soil test result.
It's knowledge designed to reduce costs and improve efficiency, and it's available on GRDC's website.